Yeah, before we get to the topic of autoencoders, let us briefly talk about dimensionality reduction. So dimensionality reduction is a broad term for describing the reduction of the number of features in a dataset. So one subtopic of dimensionality reduction would be feature selection. So if you have a data set with a large number of features, you can select a subset of these features. That would be feature selection. And there is also feature extraction. So the difference between feature selection and feature extraction is that in feature extraction, we don't necessarily keep original features. So usually feature extraction would be a combination of the features, some, for instance, linear or nonlinear transformation. I will show you an example of that in this video here. And this is also the concept that underlies autoencoders. So autoencoders can kind of be thought of as feature extraction algorithms. So autoencoders are also, the regular autoencoders at least, are also falling under the umbrella of unsupervised learning. So you have heard about unsupervised learning before, a long time ago. That was probably the first video of the semester where we talked about the three broad categories of machine learning. The first category was supervised learning, the other one was reinforcement learning, and the one category I'm talking about here is unsupervised learning. So unsupervised learning, like the name suggests, it's supervised learning but without labels, so it's unsupervised. So we are only using the features, not the labels. We are ignoring the target variable here. So there are problems where we simply don't have a target variable. Sometimes we may have a target variable, but we may decide not to use it. So there are different types of applications and goals when we talk about unsupervised learning. So for instance, one goal could be finding a hidden structure in the data or compressing data, let's say for storage needs. Also, some machine learning algorithms are very susceptible to, let's say, the curse of dimensionality. So in that way, we can just reduce the features, the number of features, to improve the performance. One would be clustering. So that is like grouping similar types of objects. It's essentially very similar to this point, retrieving similar objects. So if you have two images, it would be very hard to, let's say, compare the similarity between, let's say, two people. If you have a photograph of a person and another photograph of that person, and there's, let's say, a different background and different types of things, it would be very hard to do a pairwise comparison of all pixels to determine whether in these two pictures it's the same person or not. But what we could do is we could extract a smaller dimensional feature vector for both images and then compare these feature vectors, where we assume that whatever method we use to construct this feature vector has only focused on the essential information, like the face images or the faces in the image, and not the background, for instance. Another goal of feature extraction could be exploratory data analysis, kind of related to finding hidden structure in the data, where, for example, you want to plot a data set that is high dimensional. So, and humans, we can't really visualize more than three dimensions in a scatter plot, for example. So you could think of an application of taking a high dimensional data set, doing feature extraction into like two or three dimensions, and then plotting those. And finally, one big example would be generating new examples. So we can somehow try to learn the dataset distribution, and then we could sample from this distribution to generate new data. And this will be the topic of next lecture when we talk about variational autoencoders. I will start by showing you an example already today where we sample new data, but this way would not be ideal. A better way would be then in the next lecture, the variational autoencoders. All right, but a long story short, let me continue before we talk about autoencoders with an example of dimensionality reduction. And I think many of you have already heard about this. It's called principal component analysis. So we won't go into too much detail about principal component analysis in this class here because it's not a deep learning topic, but just on the big picture view here, what's going on in principal component analysis is that we are essentially finding the directions of maximum variance. So that would be the first step. So if you have a data set that like shown here, where these circles represent your data points, you have two feature axes, x1 and x2, and here these PC1 and PC2 represent your principal components. So these are the principal components. And they are essentially, if you think of the data set here as a matrix, as a two-dimensional matrix, these essentially represent the eigenvectors of this matrix. So PC1 is the eigenvector associated with the largest eigenvalue, and PC2 is the eigenvector associated with the second largest eigenvalue. So these are giving you essentially the directions of the maximum variance, so where the data is most spread out. So here we're assuming in this dimension, in this axis, the data is most spread out, and then this one is the PC2 is the one where it's the second most spread out. All right. So then, once we have found these principal components, these directions of maximum variance, so we are then rotating. So you can, I'm not sure why it was cut off here. X1, X2. This is our original feature space. So X1 and X2 are our original features, and here now you can see I rotated this, so I rotated this to the right, and I get two new feature axes. One is this PC2 and one is this PC1. These are my new feature axes. So I'm aligning my dataset in this new feature axis. It's essentially like a linear transformation. You can think of it essentially as a linear transformation. And then I'm considering, if I want to do dimensionality reduction, I can consider only the direction with the maximum variance and then disregard the other one. So here I would reduce my data set from two into one dimension. So for instance, I would consider this first eigenvector and just ignore the second one. And then what happens is, so you squish. So if you remove the PC2 dimension, you're squishing the data. So you can think of it just squishing everything down into one dimension here. Right, and then this is how it would look like if I would project this data only onto one dimension. And this is the principal component where the variance is most spread. So if you would do the same thing with PC2, so this would be my PC2, so you would then see that the data, so in this direction, would be less spread. So it would be more like somewhere here in the center. So many would be overlapping. So this is just a big picture concept. Of course, it's kind of boring, like going from 2D to 1D. In a real world case, we would have maybe hundreds or thousands of features and reduce that to a smaller dimensional space. So how many principal components should we keep? This is a topic where we would look at the cumulative variance retained or captured by the principal components. And this is really a topic kind of beyond this class, because it's not really deep learning. I just wanted to show you a classic dimensionality reduction technique. And in fact, autoencoders do actually something similar. So here, there's one thing I haven't mentioned yet. There's something where we have an orthogonality constraint. Autoencoders do essentially the same thing. They will give you these types of, well, kind of principal components. However, autoencoders don't have this orthogonality constraint, at least not explicitly. But except that, autoencoder with a linear activation function would be essentially like a principal component analysis. But of course, in the context of deep learning, we are talking also about nonlinear activation functions. So it's the autoencoder we will see in the next video will actually be a little bit fancier than this principal component analysis. But yeah, this was just a short overview of one classic dimensionality reduction technique. In the next video, I will show you actually how the autoencoder looks like.